Alright, hi everybody, welcome back to our 9th C++ programming lecture. So today we are going to discuss about static memory once and for all. So pretty much after this lecture you know all the uses of the static keyword and what that means in terms of memory basically. We will also start with our introduction of object-oriented programming. So this will be part one, and we will continue on object-oriented programming also in the next lecture, where we then will learn about part two. So let's first of all start with memory classes, and let's quickly recap what we learned so far. So what we learned so far is if you start up one of your program has such a memory space. It has some kernel memory segment, stack segment, some space for the heap, and it also has some data and text segment. So, and local variables and automatic variables, or local variables are sometimes referred as automatic variables because you don't need to clean up explicitly. If you put an integer within a function as a local variable, it's automatically cleaned up for you. So that's why they're called automatic variables. And such local or automatic variables go onto the stack in the stack segment of your program. Also, the stack memory manages function calls. So I won't probably go into details about that. You can read it up yourself if you're interested in how that works precisely. We, of course, also have a good old heap memory, the heap segment. So whenever you allocate some memory using new, operator new, it is allocated on the heap in the heap segment. Exactly. And then we have mysterious static memory, which we will talk about in detail today on the very first slides. And why is it, first of all, called static memory? It's called static memory because its size does not change at runtime. So we already know about global variables, right? So if whenever you define a variable with whenever you define a variable not in any function, just somewhere in your implementation file, it is a global variable, which also does not change its size at runtime. And also the lifetime of the global variable is usually the program's lifetime. And static memory, static variables are very similar because also their size does not change, and usually also their lifetime is the program's lifetime. And static memory is stored in the program's data segment. One could also say that global variables are also static in that sense. And one could argue that a static variable is basically just a global variable, but you cannot access it globally. So the visibility is somewhat restricted. But other than that, you might also think of a static variable as some kind of global variable with limited visibility that is probably a good mental model, really. So, and what can be static? What memory can be static? You can, for instance, declare variables within functions to be static. You can also have static member variables, data members. We will have examples on all those kinds of usages on the next few slides. And so maybe let's go there. So using static variables and functions within classes. So how does that look like? What you can do, obviously, is you can have a struct s. You can give it some integer variable I. You can give it some constructor, which receives one integer as a parameter, and it uses the parameter a to initialize its data member I. What you could also do is you can have even a static function. So you can also declare member functions or function members to be static function members. And you can declare also a data member to be a static one. So we can also declare a static integer j as part of the type definition s here. Then we can overload the left shift operator for the output stream, basically, to print out the contents here of a variable of type s. Here we pass it as a const sref, and then we print s.i and s.j to access its data members and print the values. First of all, notice that whenever we have static data members here, if I recall correctly, it was in the last lecture where I told you that static data members are part of the type itself. And this also means that we have to initialize static data members in a somewhat different way. I mean, here, our data member I, we can just initialize by using the constructor. When we wish to initialize the static integer j, we cannot initialize it in the constructor. Why is that? I mean, there's a good, like always in C++, even though it doesn't seem like that, there's always a good reason for stuff. So, and as I told you, a static member variable is basically kind of a global variable with a restricted visibility. And a static member variable is shared across all instances of that type. And if you would also initialize that integer j here within the constructor, you would initialize it multiple times, right? Whenever you call a constructor of that type s, you would initialize it. But I mean, it doesn't make sense to initialize a thing multiple times. So you're only allowed really to initialize it once. And that means that whenever you wish to initialize static data members, you have to initialize them outside of the function, outside of the type. So what you could write is like you say here is some kind of static variable j, which is a member of the type s. It's an integer, and here you say, yeah, I wish to initialize that with 42. So basically, initialization is kind of similar to how you initialize global variables. Yeah, you do it outside of any function or constructor or whatnot. And then, how could you use it? You could construct a variable s of type uppercase s. You give it a 10 as an integer literal as a parameter for the constructor. It's used to initialize the data member I. Then you can print s. Observe that the static data member j is statically initialized here at compile time, basically. So at this point, whenever you create s here, the data member j is already initialized to 42. So you can use the shift left operator, and it will print 10 and 42. You can, of course, also access the static data member here using the dot operator. You don't even need an instance because, I mean, static data members are shared across all instances of that type. So you can also just have the type name itself and say, yeah, colon, colon, j. Again, it's like a global variable, but you have to prefix it with the type it is defined in. And for a static member function, you also don't need an instance to call it. So you can also just have s colon colon foo, and it will call the foo function, which you defined here as a static member function of the type s. That's the idea, basically. So classes and structs can contain constant or non-constant static variables. You have to define them outside of the class. Static data members are part of the type. I already told you that in the last lecture. And j is shared across all variables of type s. Yeah. Does not require a concrete instance to access it. You can just have type name and colon colon and then access the data or function. Why is that useful? I mean, constant variables are only stored once in the program's data segment. And this, of course, saves memory. It depends on your real-world scenario that you wish to model in code. So sometimes it's quite useful to be able to make use of static memory, which is shared across all instances, because it can just save memory. And you can also, of course, kind of use or misuse it for template beta programming. That's also possible. The member function foo here is also shared across all variables of type s, so which is why you can just have s colon colon foo. Another use of the static keyword. So you can also introduce static variables within free functions. That's also something which is possible. So what you, for instance, can do is you can, within a free function, ordinary function, you can create, you can introduce a static variable. Here we introduce a counter variable of type size t, which we declare as a static one, and we initialize it to zero. And then the idea, so the effect of the static keyword here in this context is that first of all, the counter variable counter is initialized only once. So within the first function call to the function, I mean, that's how it's called, this counter variable is initialized. And then for each subsequent call of that function, this initialization is skipped and you can just use and modify it. And the counter variable here, the static counter variable, is also shared across all function calls to function. So in fact, there exists only one counter variable now in your program. So it's only one variable, which is the same for each call to this function. And it also sits in the program's data segment and it can be used. And for instance, one use case would be, yeah, you create a counter variable and you just count the number of calls this function has been called. So you can basically increment for each time the function is called, and then you basically have a function call counter, so to say. Maybe there are some use cases for that. And so counter is basically also like a global variable, but it can only access within the function implementation here. That's the idea basically. And so what you can do is you can just have a quick while loop and call your function numerous times. Here it's like 10 times. And then your counter will be 10 eventually. And static variables are defined only once. Again, the lifetime of a static variable is the program's lifetime. And it can also be quite useful sometimes, for instance, if you wish to count the number of function calls. However, I mean, same holds for static variables as for global variables. Whenever you run programs in parallel, so you should try to avoid, I mean, you should try to avoid global variables in all, under all circumstances, if possible, of course. And same basically holds for static variables, which pretty much behave like global variables, but with restricted visibility. It can be quite a pain if you need to parallelize a program and you have, you make heavily use of static variables that can lead to all sorts of danger. So that has been really troublesome. In the past, especially for the Linux kernel, at the time where the modern machines had multiple cores, or multiple cores were introduced in the machines, the operating system kernels also had to be adjusted. And some of the kernels made quite a lot of use of such static variables within function, and this is really a pain if you then try to parallelize things. So it's just a huge pain to fix. So it would be probably advisable to just not use it whenever possible. All right. And you can also have the static keyword used in static variables and static member functions. I showed you that example, but also you can declare non-member functions, so-called free functions, as static too. That's also possible. So what you could do is you could have a module H, so have some nice include guard. So please don't forget the include guard. Then you could declare a static integer variable value, and you could also declare a free function by the name of foo to be a static function, and then you will end your header file. And of course, also, I mean, here in the header files, you have the headers of functions, and also you declare some variables, but at some point you also need to define those things. And this usually happens in some implementation file, so .cpp, where you then initialize and define the integer value here, and also you provide a definition for the function foo. And by having the static keyword here put in front of the global variable or in front of the free function, this static keyword kind of restricts the visibility. So again, it's basically like global, but with a limited visibility. So it restricts visibility of variables. So static variables are only initialized once. I mean, same holds for global variables. And the variable value and the function foo now, because of the static keyword, will be only visible to the module it is defined in. So that means here in the module.cpp, you are able to use the function foo and the the variable value, but in all other implementations files, you are not, or in any other header files, you are not allowed to use those things really. So that's basically the idea. Sometimes that might be quite useful. So for instance, if you need to implement some stuff which should be internal to that module.cpp implementation file, then you can just declare functions to be static. And so no one else is allowed and able to use them. That might be quite handy sometimes. Some more use cases. I promised you some more use cases for the special this pointer. So here we go. That's one slide on some additional uses of the this pointer. So this is, of course, a pointer. And it contains the address of the receiver object. Basically, that's the object on which a member function is being called on, so to say. Where can the this pointer be used? So the this pointer can be used in any non-static member functions, and there are two additional use cases. But I'm not going to care to explain about those. Here I just present the most relevant use case. So for instance, what could you do? You could have a class by the name of T. You could have some integer data members X and Y within that class T. You could have a function foo, which for instance assigns the integer literal 6 to the data member X. And this essentially, this line here has the same meaning as this X is assigned 6, the integer literal 6 to. So you have to, you can use the this pointer. So in Java, you would probably use the this pointer, but in C++, usually you avoid it because, I mean, probably laziness of the programmers not type any unnecessary characters, really. Yeah, again, here you could also use this explicitly to tell the compiler, yeah, I really wish to set this integer, this data member X here, and I wish to assign 5 to it. What else could you do? You could also have a member function foo, which receives an integer parameter, and the parameter's name is X. Here's the problem that the parameter name X shadows the member with the same name, because we also have a data member X, and here we also have a function parameter X. This sometimes leads to a kind of dangerous situation. Here, because you have the same name. And you can, for instance, here use this pointer to disambiguate those variables. So what you would do here is you say this X, which is the data member X, we wish to assign the X to, and this unqualified X here is the data member. Not the data member, pardon, is the parameter X. So please have this formal parameter X and assign it to the data member X. That's the idea. What else can we do? We can also use the constructor's parameter X to initialize the data member X here. You see that line quite often where you don't have to use this. That works perfectly fine. So, I mean, the only sensible thing here for a constructor is to initialize the member variable with the parameter. So here you can also have the same name. But then maybe you wish to do that now here. You wish to initialize the data member Y by using the data member X, which has been initialized before. So you initialize Y with the data member X rather than the parameter X. So in this scenario, it doesn't really matter, but there might be some scenarios where it does matter. And you can use this pointer to be precise about it. You could of course also find different parameter names, but here you can also disambiguate using this pointer. And also you probably saw it previously, if you need to overload operators, sometimes you need to return a ref to the thing itself. And for that, you can just return the dereferenced this pointer here to make it work. All right, that would be it. That would be it on the static keyword and static memory. So you now know pretty much all about memory classes in C++, what are the different kinds of memory that they exist, and you know all the mechanisms, how to put what data in what memory. So again, just use local variables to be put on the stack, use memory allocated with operator new for the heap. And you can use global or static variables to put data on the in the data segment of your program's memory layout, so to say. So you will have full control of where you wish to put data. Next, let's talk about the ideas of object-oriented languages, which C++ could be considered to be one of. So what you hear maybe in Computer Science 1, in CS1 lectures, they will tell you, yeah, what's the idea of object-oriented programming? And the idea might be, or the answer might be to that question, which you maybe have already heard about. Yeah, it's the concept of describing real-world objects. That's object orientation. So, and I have to be careful about my wording, not to be that rude. But this statement is really absolutely nonsense. So, of course, that's somewhat true, but that's probably the least important idea of object-oriented programming. So that's complete nonsense, basically. So object orientation has three real foundations, which are which make it to be in great demand. And those foundations are, first of all, encapsulation, which we will talk about today. So encapsulation is very important. Inheritance, also very, very important. We will cover all those three foundations in today's lecture. And at last, we have polymorphism. So if you introduce object-oriented programming, what this allows you is you can define functions to behave polymorphically, or you can define types to behave polymorphically. And this is probably the third one is probably the most important thing for the real world, for a real world software development, followed by inheritance and encapsulation. And this first statement here is probably nonsense. Okay, spoiler alert, but what's the problem here? So of course, those are the three foundations of object-oriented programming. And you have to understand those concepts and the idea behind object-oriented programming, of course. It's pretty much expected from you. But the problem is that you need the concept and ideas of object-oriented programming pretty much only if you really have to design and implement large software systems. And this pretty much never happens at universities. I mean, see in our exercise class here, for instance, I can only really give you some small tasks because you have to be able to solve them within a week. And of course, you also have different lectures that you also need to attend, and other courses also require you to do the exercises, the accompanying exercises. So you can't really at your university design and implement large software systems, which is yeah, very unfortunate, but that's just how it is. And the problem is that you only really need those concepts usually if you need to implement larger stuff. So for the small exercise classes and small tasks in the exercises, that's not really necessary. And yeah, so, but for reality later on, maybe if you choose to become a software engineer or software developer, you need to be prepared, you need to know about those concepts and make use of them and use them effectively. That's the main idea here. You need to know the mechanisms, essentially. Okay, so let's start. Model objects using classes and structs. What does it mean? So if you go ahead and look up what's an object for C++, it will tell you, yeah, a very broad definition. So an object is a region of storage. So that also means that in C or C++, an integer would also be considered as an object, because it's, yeah, just region of storage, usually 4 bytes on most modern machines, double, maybe 8 bytes on most modern machines. So that would also be considered as an object. So what do we mean with object-oriented thinking? For a real-world object, so what we do is we usually model it as a class or a struct. So we make a real-world object a data type, a user-defined data type, struct or class. And what we also do is we abstract away from any from the concrete object, and we only really model the essential properties as data members usually. So what we do is we abstract away from the real world object and we model only the essential problems using user-defined types. And the capabilities of the object that we wish to model, we just use member functions for. So we model capabilities of an object using member functions. That's the basic idea. And an object also might interact, of course, with other objects. We will have also an example on that on the next slide, if I recall correctly. So what we could do, for instance, we could model the kind of not so real world object, a matrix from mathematics. That's perfectly fine. That's probably a good example here. So, and of course, a matrix from mathematics has a number of rows. It also has a number of columns and it has some entries. So you may want to model those properties here as data members. And of course, a matrix also has some functionalities, and it can be, for instance, multiplied with another matrix object. So you would probably have a member function or an operator maybe that you overload to basically express how two matrices interact with each other. So another example, maybe also from mathematics, that's just how it works here. And you could model a triangle from the vector space R3, like in computer graphics. So the computer graphic guys would probably do it like that. A triangle has some properties, of course. In order to define a triangle in vector space R3, you probably need three-dimensional points to specify the triangle, first of all. Maybe you have some additional properties. And of course, a triangle also has some capabilities. So you might be able to calculate its area. So you might also be able to calculate its circumference. So basically the way around the triangle. And a triangle also might interact with other stuff. So you may wish to have some member functions that calculate intersections with other objects, maybe triangles, maybe other triangles, maybe planes, and whatnot. Or maybe also with a line, or how is it called in computer graphics? Not a line, array. So if you implement a ray tracer, you shoot some rays through a 2D image plane, and then you basically compute interactions with objects, and then you find out the pixels RGB value to render a nice colorful image. That's maybe computer graphics explained in a nutshell. So, for instance, this might be one example how it could be used in computer graphics, but I mean, you can model it as you like, depending on your domain, and wherever you have to solve problems. So use a struct or a class to model a description. So the type definition acts as a kind of description of such objects, or as a blueprint, if you will. And if you create a variable of that struct or class data type that you just defined, the blueprint, then you create an instance that would be called a concrete object. Yeah, exactly. So, and anyhow, remember that was the least important thing, which I also called nonsense previously. Now let's go to the more important things here. So encapsulation, that's very important. And I will also at the final slide also, I will link, I will refer to some very interesting talks about software engineering, and you will also find that encapsulation is a very important thing. So within encapsulation, you basically hide programming details which are not relevant for the users of your type or functionalities that you implement. So first of all, we have a separation. So we have two kinds of ways of encapsulate stuff. So we can separate data and interface using the public, private, protected specifier. Today, we will also learn about what protected here can be used for. And whenever, for instance, you create a class, you can have some public and private specifiers here. And you can say, yeah, usually what you do is you have the data members as private members, and you have the function members declared public, such that you really separate data from interface, and you can only really manipulate the data through a well-defined interface. That's basically the idea. And in C++, we also have another level of encapsulation, basically, which is a bit more, not abstract, but on a different level, so to say. So here we can also separate interface and implementation using header and implementation files. We will also have an example on that on the next slide. And why is that useful? Maybe here to give you an example, TVs. So if you have two TVs, so you can probably turn both TVs on and off. You can maybe switch programs. Maybe you can set the volume and some other stuff. But I guess the internal implementation of those TVs might be quite different from one another. But still, the interface is the same. So you can switch both things on and off. You can switch programs. You can turn up or down the volume. But the implementation is different. But for the user of a TV, it doesn't really matter. Yeah. So you wish to hide how it's implemented internally. That's the basic idea. And to give you an example on the kind of encapsulation separation of header and implementation file, let's have an example. Maybe let's have header for a matrix data type. So we use keyword class to define a new data type. We give it some data members, so a number of rows, a number of columns, and we also provide a vector of doubles to store the matrix entries. And then we provide a public interface, so we provide a constructor and some member functions, which we can use to access the private data. You can, for instance, overload the operator multiplication here to encode a matrix multiplication, or we can scale up or down a matrix. That is perfectly fine. And then, of course, we have a corresponding implementation file, which includes the matrix header. And here in this implementation file, we provide implementations for all those functions, for all those member functions, or also free functions. If you would have any additional free functions here in the header, we would also define them here in the implementation file. And the idea really is that the user of that type only needs to know about the interface in order to interact with that type. So, and the concrete implementation is pretty much hidden. And if you're good and if you have good interfaces and good implementations, User will not even recognize a change in the implementation. He might only recognize a change in the implementation in the sense that maybe the implementation of the matrix multiplication became faster or better in any sense, like faster, less memory or whatnot. But the semantics, the behavior is still the same, really. And the implementation can be easily swapped or changed. Let's have an example here. Let's have a main file, main.cpp, which uses the matrix type. In order to be able to use the matrix type here, we would need to include the matrix.h header file, of course, such that we know how the type is to be used. So we need to know about its data layout. We also need to know about what member functions are available. And then, of course, at some point, we need an implementation, matrix.cpp maybe, which includes the matrix header and provides implementations for all the functions declared here. And then, of course, what we now do is at some point we compile the project here. So we compile main and create an object file of that, so main.o for main.object file. We also compile matrix.cpp and produce an object file of that, so matrix.o. And at some point, the linker links those files together, and we finally end up with our executable program. But what we could also do is we could create a better matrix implementation, maybe. So maybe you are smarter than your colleagues, you can craft a faster matrix multiplication or whatnot, or implementation of the whole type, really. So you would also include the matrix header, provide different, better implementations maybe. You would compile it into a better matrix.o. And then rather than linking those files together, you can just link these files here together. And still the program would work and function correctly. But maybe you improved on some of the internal details, really. All right. Pretty much it about encapsulation. So now we go to the even more interesting stuff, inheritance and polymorphism. So in object-oriented programming, you also have inheritance. What does it mean? So what that means is that structs or classes, or essentially data types, can inherit from each other. What does it mean? What does it result in? This really results in the inheritance of features. So a child class inherits or will inherit all the capabilities of its parent class or maybe even classes. So in C++ there's also something which is called multiple inheritance, which means that you as a class can inherit from multiple parent classes. And then you obtain all the capabilities and all the functionalities that the parents classes have. So which means that the child basically obtains all the data members of the parent classes and also all the function members of the parent classes. And also what's very interesting, and this is very important for polymorphic behavior, a child class or struct, so child type, can also be further extended, first of all, and it can be further specialized, which is very important here. We will have plenty of examples on the next few slides. And also, inheritance is or forms an is a structure. To give you an example, a duck is some kind of bird. Probably you would think that's true. A bird is some kind of animal, yeah, still pretty much true. And maybe an animal would be some kind of creature. That's pretty much it probably. I just leave it be. So, and that means that you kind of form an inheritance tree. So you have a data type duck, which is also a data type bird. So bird is also a type. Would also have some type animal, and bird is animal, and you also have some creature type, and animal would inherit the features of the creature type. So that's one very important thing to note. So we form with inheritance, we form an is a structure. Yeah, What is the clue? Why would you ever wish to use inheritance? You would use inheritance for polymorphic behavior as one aspect, which we will talk about later on. But also it will save you some typing. It will save you to type the same stuff over and over again. And here, if you just use plain inheritance, it's pretty much about code reuse. Yeah, you're reusing existing code rather than copy and pasting it. Because, I mean, whenever you copy and paste code, you may introduce errors. At least it's more error prone than just using existing stuff. And also, if you ever need to change stuff in your implementation and you just copy and pasted stuff, you need to change it in all the files you copy and pasted to, and hopefully you don't make a mistake, really. And so it's error prone and really tedious work. So again, as I just said, imagine you have to change, you have to make a change in a class, and maybe you need to extend the logic of a class. In the copy version, you really need to touch every single type that implements the stuff and uses the code in the copy and paste version. So it's just terrible. However, if you use inheritance, and if you include some of the base features, base functionalities in a base type, and if you have some derived types that all derive from the base type, all those derived types will have the features and functionalities of the parent type. And whenever you need to make a change to some logic, to some function implementations, you really only need to do it in the parent class, and then all of your children, all of your child classes will automatically kind of receive the changes because they inherit from the parent class. And that's much more convenient, probably. Yeah, really just much easier to use. So how does it work? How would you express that in C++ code? Here's an example. Here's the syntax, how you would do it. You, for instance, let's create a type parent. We use the class keyword for that here. Have a private int parent value. Have a public constructor, which just takes one parameter and uses the parameter here to initialize the data member parent value. We also define a print function, a member function print, which just prints the parent value here using the left shift operator. What we can do now, and this is inheritance here, right here. So we can now also introduce another type, child, which we also make our model as a class. And whenever you use the colon behind a type name here, basically, class child, and then you say colon, and then the type that you wish to inherit from, that's inheritance here. That basically means, I wish to define a type by the name of child, and the child type should inherit from this other data type. Please ignore the public here for 1 second. I will explain what the public means here to you in a few moments. But the meaning of that is here. Define a new type, child, and inherit from parent. That's inheritance. And we can now give our child type also private integer as a data member, child value maybe. We can also have a constructor for child, which receives two integers, I and j. We use the integer I to initialize our own data member child value. So we initialize child value to whatever I is the parameter here. And we use the parameter constructor's parameter j to call the parents constructor. So it might be a good idea to also initialize the stuff that we inherited. And we can call the parents constructor here and give it the integer, because I mean the parents constructor expects an integer, and we give it j. And then the parents constructor will be called, and it will initialize the parent value here with that j parameter. And then we can, of course, also implement a print member function here, which first of all prints the child value. and which also called the parents print function. So we could now also explicitly call the print function that the parent implements by having the type name of the thing that we inherited from parent. Then we have colon colon print. That means we call the print function of the parent type. How could such a child and parent type be used? So we could have a parent P constructed here and call the print function, would work perfectly fine. And we can also have a child C, give it two integers to the constructor here. I mean, that's what it expects. And we can call the print function here and it will do the stuff which we defined here. So that's basically pretty much inheritance here. So we inherit from parent, which means we inherit this integer, and also we inherit the constructor, and we inherit the member function print from the parent, and we can make use of those stuff in our child class. All right, now let's talk about visibility modes and inheritance modes. So that's the public private protected thingy. So yeah, we have public private protected, and we can, whenever we define a type using struct or class, we can have the keywords public, for instance, to denote that this is a public integer which can be just accessed by any user of that type base. We can also declare a data member, and the same also holds for member functions, by the way. So we can also have a private data member J, which can only really be accessed by any thing which is defined in base. And we can also have protected data members, or also, I mean, again, the same holds for member functions. We can also have protected member functions. And here the keyword protected now means whenever you have protected stuff in a data type, that means that, of course, you yourself can access K. So if you have any member functions here within the base type, you would be able to access the value K within those member functions. And whenever stuff is protected, also if you have children of that base class, those would also be allowed to access protected data member or function members. Okay. So protected means you yourself can access that stuff, and also everything that inherits from you that can also access protected stuff. So those are the visibility modes, so to say. We already pretty much knew about those, with an exception of protected, which I just explained here. I just explained that. And here we also now have inheritance modes, which also use public, private, protected keyword. And this was the public, which we used in the inheritance line pretty much. So we could have a public inheritance. So we can derive a class, derived one, and use public inheritance from the base type. And what that means, that everything that is aware of the derived one also inherits from base. Oh, that doesn't make too much sense, right? So anyhow, so everything that is aware of derived one is also aware of the stuff that comes from base. That means all users of derived one also have access to whatever base provides here. And everything that is aware of the derived one is aware of the base thingy here, or that we derived from base. If I say derived and inherit, I mean basically the same thing. We also have private inheritance, so no one but derived two in this case is aware of the inheritance. That means you basically keep it quiet, keep it to you that you just inherited from another type. Other users or users of derived two do not know about this inheritance here. And you can also have protected inheritance. That means only derived tree is aware of the inheritance and all of derived tree's children are aware of that inheritance here, that derived tree inherited from base. Yeah, that might sound complicated. There are some exotic use cases where it's advisable to use private or protected inheritance. But from practice, I can also say that for the most parts, nobody cares, and public inheritance mode is pretty much used all the time. However, of course, there might be some exceptions in, in some exotic, more exotic use cases. So let's build a class hierarchy such that we can do stuff or do more advanced stuff. So, and now this is here computer science CS1 lecture 101. So, I mean, this is always the example we have. It's about shapes, right? So we have a base class shape. Then we have a triangle, which is also some kind of shape, probably. We also maybe have a right triangle, which is some subtype of the triangle class. So because it's a more specialized version of the general triangle, because here this thingy has a right angle. Then we may have a circle, which can also be considered as a shape. We might also have a rectangle, which is also some kind of shape. So here we can build a class hierarchy. And here this thing also forms an is a structure. So a right triangle is some kind of triangle, and a triangle is some kind of shape. And the same holds for circle. Circle and rectangle are also some kind of shape. So how would we express this in code? So if we wish to basically pretty much model that hierarchy here, we would probably go ahead, define a type shape. And then we define a type a triangle, and we let triangle inherit all the stuff from shape. We can also have rectangle, and have rectangle inherit all the stuff from shape, and the same holds for circle. And we can also have a right triangle, which on the other hand inherits everything from triangle rather than from shape. And by transitivity, right triangle also inherits, of course, everything from shape through the intermediate type triangle. This is how you would model that in C++ code. Now that's a bit boring, so we only have empty types which can't do anything really. So maybe let's add some functionalities. Let's, for instance, add a draw function. So it would be really nice if we can draw all the shapes. And for that thing, we just provide a draw function. And here in our case, we be smart about it. So let's be smart. Let's not copy and paste. Copy and paste version would be the terrible version, would be we add a draw function for each of the type. But that would also mean if whenever we have to change something in the logic, we need to change this, change it in all the types of that hierarchy, which is pretty much not a very clever way. So make use of inheritance and only provide a draw function to the shape class. And then all of a sudden, all the subtypes of that shape class can also draw. Let's have an example. So what we add is a public function draw, and it just prints shape to the command line. And now all the subtypes, circle, rectangle, triangle, right triangle, pardon, also all those subtypes can be drawn. And here in draw, in our simple example, it's just printing stuff to the command line. Yeah, that's the basic idea, really. But now we have kind of one problem. Not all shapes shall be printed as shape. So because, I mean, it's somewhat correct, because circle is, essentially a shape. In some sense, but circle is also probably a more precise shape, a more fine grain subtype of a shape. So actually what we wish to do is we have a circle printing circle rather than the more general shape That's a problem. So how do we solve that? What we actually wish is we wish to specialize the draw function depending on the subtype. So what we wish to do is we wish having circle printing circle, we wish to have rectangle printing rectangle. So basically, specialize on the subtype. So how do we do it? We can of course also do that. We can specialize depending on the subtype. So we wish to specialize draw. And in order to make that work is we can make the draw function virtual. Oh, virtual functions. Sounds frightening, but it's not very frightening at all. It's rather relatively easy. So whenever you wish to specialize a member function depending on the subtype, you have to make the function a virtual one. This is unlike Java. In Java, everything is virtual. Every function member is virtual. You can override pretty much everything. C++ following the zero overhead principle, you only pay for what you're using. You have to be explicit about it. So by default, a member function is not virtual, and you have to be explicit about it and add the keyword virtual. So we have a virtual destructor, which we just set to default. Why we need a virtual destructor? Why we need to add a virtual destructor? I will explain to you in a few moments. Let's first of all be concerned with the draw method. So what did we do? We only really added the virtual keyword here, and this is pretty much all. So now the draw function is virtual. And it still prints shapes, so, and it still behaves like an ordinary member function. But by making this draw function here virtual, the draw function can now be overwritten by the subtypes. And this is called specialization. So we specialize the implementation of the draw function. So what we could do is we could have the draw function of the parent thing, of the parent shape. We override it. Here, please use the keyword override. And we provide a different implementation, a somewhat more specialized implementation, which just prints circle to the command line. And the same thing pretty much for all the other shapes here. So for the rectangle, we override the draw function and let it print rectangle. And same holds for for the triangle class or type, and for the right triangle type. So be smart, use override to denote specialized functions. I believe, if I correctly, prior C++11, I'm not sure if you could not do it, or if you could not override here, or use the, I mean, you could override, but there, if I recall correctly, the override keyword here only has been introduced in C++11. But look it up yourself if you're interested in when that happened. However, whenever you really wish to override a function, a member function, also be explicit about it and use the override keyword. That's very important, because imagine if you don't use override. So the virtual function draws a shape. And now if you wish to specialize, you go ahead and type the same function name as the parent's function, so draw again, and specialize it. But imagine if someone in the code base had to change the shape type. And maybe a change had to be made, and the draw function had to be renamed. Maybe, draw to command line or something like that. And then all of a sudden, you have here a virtual function which is called draw to the command line. And here you have a function draw, which does not override anymore because the name in the base class had been changed. And now you introduced a new semantics. So that's no longer an override here, which can lead to great danger, really. So, and by putting the override keyword right behind the function that you wish to override, the compiler will check if there exists such a virtual function within one of the base types that you inherit from. So please use override such that the compiler will can check, and the compiler will let you know if there's something wrong with your implementation. So that's very, very important. Yes, can lead to great dangerous situations. And now, as we have virtual functions and as we have specializations, we can now use polymorphism. Because, I mean, on the last slide, you might argue, now each of the data types still has its own draw implementation, which differs from the base type. So isn't that just the copy and paste method? Not quite. So first of all, we don't have to use override. If we don't wish to use override, we can still just use the plain function from the parent. So that still would not work in the copy and paste version. And also what the overrides allow us now is polymorphism, introducing polymorphic behavior, which I'll show you in the following. I went ahead of myself here. That's what I just explained. So that's still not copy and paste, because we have specialized draw, and what we did with that is achieved polymorphism, which was ultimately our goal. And types in the type hierarchy now behave polymorphically. And why is that? Here comes the clue. Example, let's take the circle type. And the circle type is, of course, of type circle. But the circle type is also of type shape, because it inherits from the shape type. So a circle is both. The circle is a circle and a shape. And that's great news. Here's our example. And now let's have a fancy usage of that. Here comes the clue. So we can now have a print shape function, which accepts as a parameter a const ref to a shape. Pardon. Which receives as a parameter a const ref to a shape. And in print shape, we just call the draw function. And the great thing is now that using the print shape function, all of the specialized draw functions will be called. So what that means, we will have an example here. So you can now have a circle, C. You can have a right triangle, RT. You can have any variables of any of those types, really. And you can call the print shape function. And print shape now calls the draw method on those variables, C and RT. And what will be called here? What draw? It's not the shape, because C is of type circle, C is of type right triangle, but I mean, they're all inherit from shape. So that means, first of all, the type system is fine with that, because circle and right triangle are still some kind of shape. But at this call site here, for the first call, the circle specialization will be called. So this draw method will be called, or this draw function. And for the second call, where you put in a right triangle, the right triangle draw version will be called, and it will print R triangle to the command line. And isn't that great? And here comes some word of caution. Why do we need the mysterious virtual destructor? If you look that up on the internet, you will find the following explanation. If a C++ type is meant to be used polymorphically, its destructor has to be declared virtual. Otherwise, if the static type of an object to be deleted differs from from its dynamic type, the behavior is undefined. What does it mean? Maybe let's have a look at a code example. By using inheritance and overriding virtual functions, you can now have a shape pointer S And you can allocate dynamically on the heap an object of type circle. And you have the runtime type circle, because new allocates at runtime. you allocate a thing of type circle, and you put it into a shape pointer. So static type of the variable s, so here this is a pointer variable s, and its static type is shape, but its dynamic type is circle. But this still works, because a circle is some subtype of shape. But in this case, in this line, we create something where the static type, which is shape, differs from the dynamic type, which is circle. So what we could, for instance, do now is we could just call s.draw or s.error.draw, and it will look up its dynamic type, which is circle, and it will print circle to the command line, the specialized version of the subtype circle. And here comes the catch regarding the virtual destructor. So if we now delete a pointer of static type shape, we have to use a virtual destructor, otherwise the correct destructor of the circle type would not be called. Because here, again, it's similar to the specialized draw function. We also need to be able to call delete on the static type shape, and it must be forwarded to the destructor of circle, which just means we need to make the destructor shape virtual such that it can be further specialized in the circle type. That's the basic idea. So whenever you have a type where you have a virtual function, you pretty much always need to have a virtual destructor as well. That's very important to notice. So polymorphism. So what can we do? We can do the following. We have circle C and right triangle RT, and we can call the print shape methods with C, and it will, the print shape method here will accept all things of type shape. So we can put C in it, and we will call, or we will print circle to the command line. We can also go ahead now and have a function print triangle, which you unfortunately can't see, but it should be somewhere here. And the print triangle version is able to print all triangles alike, right triangle, for instance. So the idea here is that print shape now accepts a shape and any of its subtypes. Ah, here it is. And the print triangle method accepts a triangle and any of its subtypes. And note that we pass by reference. So the polymorphic behavior only works if we pass by reference or by pointer of any kind. It could also be a smart pointer, but we have to pass by pointer or reference. Okay. Yeah, I just said that. So such polymorphic behavior is only possible when passing by reference or by pointer. Why not by value, one could ask. Please remember, whenever you have a function and you just specify a plain value type as a parameter, the thing that you put in as a parameter is copied. So it accepts a shape, but if you put in a circle, it will make a shape copy of that circle. And so within that function, within that function, S is still a shape, and it will draw a shape every single time. Because, again, whatever you put in, it can be a shape, of course, but you only make a shape copy of that subtype. So, and this does not allow for polymorphic behavior. If you wish to allow polymorphic behavior, you have to use a ref or a pointer. All right, that's also very important to note. Here we have another example using smart pointers, so you can not only use ordinary pointers, but you can also be smart about it and use smart pointers. Let's have a struct shape again, all the good stuff. Let's have a rectangle, let's have a circle, And then let's have a print shape method which accepts a shared pointer to a shape s, and it calls the draw function on that shared pointer to a shape, and it will emit polymorphic behavior. So whenever you put in a shared pointer to a rectangle, it will print rectangle. Whenever you put in a shared pointer of circle, you put in circle. You print out circle, or if you have a plane shape, it will print shape. To make it more kind of frightening, we can now have a function which we call random shapes, and we give it a parameter n, and this random shape function will create a vector of n random shapes referred to by smart pointers, by shared pointers here to be precise. So within our rand shapes implementation, we have a vector of shared pointers to shapes, which we call shapes. We have a Mersenne twister as a random number generator. So when you ever need random numbers, you can use a Mersenne twister. You need to include the header random. We can also in C++ get ourselves a nice uniform integer distribution where we specify using a template parameter that we wish to obtain random integers. And we can, or this is our generator, so to say, our number generator. And we specify the range here, so we wish to obtain random integers between 0 and 2. So 0, 1, or 2 can be the outcome of that uniform int distribution. Then we can have a nice a nice while loop, which just iterates 10 times. And in the switch, we call the distribution to generate a number. And the distribution also wishes to get a random number generator as a parameter, so we give it the Mersenne twister here, and we will, this expression so returns values from 0 to 2 at random in a uniform distribution. And then what we can do is, in case a 0 has been returned, we can add to the vector shapes, we can push back, create a new shared pointer to a shape object that we allocate on the heap. So again, make shared under the hood allocates dynamically and gives you a shared pointer. And so we break, and in case a 1 has been returned, we add we allocate a rectangle and make a shared pointer to it. And for the circle, same story. And then at the very end, we return the vector of shapes. All right, and how can we use that thing? So we can now call the rand shapes, and we can say, yeah, please give me 10 random shapes. And here we just use auto. So, I mean, the type would be here vector of shared pointers to shapes. And here we can use a range for loop, also using the auto keyword. So for each shape in that vector of shapes, just call the print shape method. And the print shape method will call the draw function on the underlying shape. And it will print the corresponding shapes, so shape, rectangle, or circle. And now my question to you is, how does the print also the same holds for the previous slides, how does the print shape method at this call site, how does it know what draw function to be called? How does it know? I mean, we just put in a shape, but how does it know whether it should call shape, rectangle, or circle? Especially if we created that stuff dynamically here and ran at random. So how does it work? That's now the trick question. So how can polymorphism, how does it work? That's the question. Before we explain the details of dynamic polymorphism and how that works, we probably also wish to compare it to static polymorphism. So in C++, there is also a thing which is called static polymorphism. Oh, pardon. And static polymorphism also does not work in C. So in C, you can't have static polymorphism, and especially you can't have dynamic polymorphism. You would need to model it, but C++ provides that all out of the box pretty much. So maybe let's first of all talk about static polymorphism. Static polymorphism binds function calls at compile time. So what the heck does that mean? Again, let's have a struct shape and a struct rectangle, and observe that those functions here are not virtual. I'm sorry. So those are not virtual member functions. Those are ordinary member functions, and each type implements its draw function in a different way. Here we print shape, here we print rectangle. So those are completely different functions. What we could now do is we could now have static polymorphism. So what we could do is we could have a print shape function, which again also accepts here in the first case a const shape ref. And it prints s.draw, so it will call the draw method of a shape. And here, the print shape, they have a second print shape method, which is also a completely different function, but it has the same name. And this is why it's called static polymorphism. So we can go ahead, have a function with the same name, but a different argument type, const rectangle ref. And this print shape only accepts rectangles or const references to a rectangle. And therefore also this s.draw binds statically. So this s.draw call always calls to this rectangle version here because it only accepts rectangles. And this print shape s.draw binds also statically at the shapes version of draw. And those are not virtual, so those are completely different functions. So, and also in the compiler, maybe I can show it to you in the exercise class. The compiler will generate two separate shape functions and will add something which is called name mangling, and it will add information on the type to make this function name different from that one. Although here in our language, we have the same name. But as long you can still have the same function names, but with different typed parameters, and the compiler will be able to distinguish between those functions. But in any case, those are different print shape functions. So what does it mean? We can now have, as an example, we can have a shape S and a rectangle R. We can print shape and give it the shape, and we can call the print shape function and give it a rectangle R. This print shape function, the first print shape function call is going to this function definition here, to this print shape version. The second function call to print shape goes to that print shape function because you put in a rectangle. And here you put in some kind of shape. And so those two call sites to print shape call to completely different functions. So this print shape is a different function. Differs from that print shape function. And this is called static polymorphism, and here those calls bind statically. On the other hand, you have also dynamic binding, which is using polymorphism at runtime. Here we have a struct shape, here we have virtual functions. Here we have a rectangle which inherits from shape, and it overrides the draw method to print rectangle. And here we only need one print shape function. So we only have one print shape function, which accepts a const ref to a shape. And this s.draw, this cannot bind statically because s.draw is virtual. So you don't know what a user is going to put in as a type. Could be a shape or could be a rectangle. Or a user could also just create another subtype of shape, craft a different implementation for the draw function, and put in that type. And so this print shape function here does not know what draw function to be called statically. So it needs a runtime check, and it needs to check at runtime the concrete type of that shape. That's the idea here, really. And the quest And the question now is, how does that really work? I mean, how can this s.draw, how can this function now, what needs to be called here? First of all, let's have an example again. You can have shape s, rectangle r. You can call print shape 2 times, and it will be always this print shape function. There's only one print shape function in the scenario on the right-hand side. And how the print shape function in the polymorphic, how have I called it? In the polymorphic, in the dynamic polymorphism, how does it know which function to be called? This is handled by something, or this is implemented by something which is called a virtual function table. Sometimes also, in short, a V table. Again, let's have another example and let's see how it works. So let's have a struct A, and let's have a virtual destruct, and let's have 2 other virtual functions, print and other. Let's have a struct B, which inherits from A but doesn't overwrite anything. And let's also have a struct C, which inherits from A and it overwrites the print function. And now again, we have the same story here. Basically, we have one call print function and it accepts a ref to an A. But as the print function, which is called here, is virtual, it can print everything that is A or a subtype of A. But again, now the same question here, what print is called? And how it's implemented internally in the compiler is that every class that specifies at least one virtual function will get its virtual function table. So each type which has at least one virtual function will be given a virtual function table. And each type A, B, and C will have a pointer to a virtual function table. And whenever you have such a dynamic call site here, where you only can decide at runtime which print is being called, what this call site here has to do basically, or the compiler will do it for you, the compiler will look up the vtable pointer of the variable A. So each type of A or any of its subtypes has a pointer to a vtable now. And the compiler will look into the will follow that pointer to the vtable, and it will look up in the vtable what function needs to be called for that variable. And then it can decide on what print function needs to be called. That's the basic idea. Maybe I can give you a better example here. So let's have an int main. Let's have B of uppercase of type name uppercase B, and let's have a C of uppercase type name C. Let's call the call print function once with B and once with a C. So how do we decide on what is going to be printed? So the type B now has a V table. So for each type that defines at least one virtual function, I already said that, it will receive a virtual function table. So the compiler will generate that for you. So B's virtual function table will look as follows. B inherits from A without overwriting anything. So that means whenever you call print on a type, on a variable of type B, it will just call A's version of print. Whenever you call the function other on a variable of type B, it will call A's version of the other function. Let's have let's check for type C. So type C also will get a vtable. The compiler will generate that for you. So here, whenever you call the print function of a variable of type C, it will actually call C's version of print because C overwrites print here. And whenever someone calls the other function on a variable of type C, it will call A's version of other because, I mean, C inherits from A and C does not overwrite the other function, so it will just use A's implementation of other. So what happens then in the call print function, it looks up the vtable by using the vtable pointer, which is stored in every variable of such a type, and it will look for the index, which is given to determine the correct function to be called. And maybe let's talk about efficiency. So efficiency compared to a normal function call, where the decision what function is being called is made statically, the runtime overhead is within 25%. In reality, it's usually much faster, but it has some overhead because you can't at such an indirect call site here. This is also called the indirect call site. You can't directly call the function because you have to make a lookup first. And this I have to make a lookup first is somewhat more expensive. And this is why you have some runtime overhead. And also it requires some space overhead, because you need one pointer to a vtable for each variable that specifies at least one virtual function. So you have one pointer to a vtable per variable, which you can't see, but the compiler under the hood will do it for you. And you will have one vtable per type. So for each type B and C, and also, yeah, I didn't draw A, but each type has its vtable, which looks like follows. And then each variable of a certain type has a pointer to the respective vtable then. And then at such dynamic call sites, it will be looked up at runtime and the correct function can be called. Yeah, and some guys previously in the exercises also ask, why do I need C++ for that? I can also model that kind of polymorphic behavior within C. So in C, you can also just add, you can also have structs and add function pointers to the polymorphic, to model polymorphic behavior. But that's much more tedious to do and also error prone. Here, by using this system in C++, by using inheritance and virtual functions, you get it basically for free. In the sense that the compiler will do all the hard work for you. The compiler will generate the virtual tables, virtual function tables. The compiler will also introduce the special vtable pointer and add it to your variable. So the compiler will take care of all the complex stuff. So you can just use that great mechanism of polymorphic behavior here and don't have to worry and implement that stuff yourself. So that's also one a great benefit of C++. Here's another example which I found on the internet, maybe to explain the idea in some more detail, but basically in essence it's the same. So we have a base type virtual destructor, two virtual functions, function 1 and 2. We have a derived 1 which inherits from base, it overrides function 1. We have a derived 2 inherits from base, overrides function 2. And basically the compiler would make the following out of that. So it would have a class base and it will add a function pointer to a vtable pointer basically, which you can't see, but I mean that's just for just as a concept in pseudocode here. And then basically you have that and in reality it will look like that. So the base type, every variable of a base type has a vtable pointer, which points to the vtable of the base class. And of course, the vtable of the base class now has two entries for those functions, function 1 and function 2. And it prints to its own implementations, of course. And D1 inherits base and overrides function 1, which means D1's vtable pointer points to D1 vtable. Again, I said it, so each type has its own vtable. And function 1 points to D1's function 1, because we override it here. And the entry for function 2 points to base's version of function 2, because we do not override it here. And same story. a similar story for D2. We inherit from base, so the virtual function table pointer points to the virtual function table of D2, and the function 1, the entry for the function 1 points to base's function 1 because we don't override anything in terms of function 1. In function 2, we do override here, and therefore it points to D2's function 2 implementation, basically. So that's the idea how the polymorphic behavior, the dynamic dispatch, often called, is implemented. We have one more special case, which is called interfaces. So what is an interface? I mean, it is not any more complex than what we already learned about. It's some kind of special case. So an interface is also called an abstract class or an abstract struct, and a class or a type is an interface type whenever it misses one or more functions implementation. And then it's called an abstract class, so an abstract class misses one or more function implementations, and it cannot be instantiated, so you cannot create variables of such an abstract type because, again, it misses some function implementations. So why? Yeah, because an interface is an abstract class with method function definition, so yeah, it doesn't make sense to create variables of that thing. Why is there a need for interfaces? So what's the idea behind interfaces, one might ask. The example is simple. So a bird might quack. So it makes quack quack. But it is probably not very useful, semantical sense, it's probably not useful to inherit from a base class quacker. That probably doesn't make too much sense. So, and for such things, I mean, this is of course the made up example, but in reality you also have those situations where it just does not make sense to have a base class quacker. And in that case, just make it an interface then. And how you could then model it is a duck might inherit from bird, which makes probably sense. And it additionally implements the quack interface because a duck might quack, but maybe a bird does some other stuff, some other noises, maybe it can't quack. So here you can model it using an interface. So we will have a code example on the next slide, hopefully. And an interface just specifies what needs to be implemented still. So how would you do it? You could, for instance, model a class bird, give it a virtual destructor, give it a virtual function fly, so a bird might fly, ordinary fly, nothing special, so to say. And now you can also have an interface, a quack interface, which also virtual destructor, and it has an interface method for which you provide no implementation. So this is a virtual member function, doQuack, and if you use the syntax equals zero after such a function's parameter list here, equals zero, then you say, yeah, I don't provide any implementation, and by doing that, you make it an interface. So quack is now an interface. And how could it be used? Here you could now go ahead and create a type duck, which inherits from bird. And in addition, it implements the quack interface. So maybe a duck also flies the ordinary bird style fly, maybe. So it doesn't override the fly method or the fly function. But it now needs to implement the quack interface because the quack interface itself has no implementation. So the duck implements quack and it just prints quack quack to the command line. And now you have a duck which you can instantiate and can create a variable of d. You can call fly on it, so and it can fly, and then it can also quack by calling do quack the interface implementation here that duck provides. The following line does not work. Again, I already said that. So you can't instantiate interfaces because quack is an interface or also oftentimes called an abstract class, which again misses at least one function implementation. And in this case, it misses exactly one function implementation. Therefore, you can't create variables of that type. Okay. one last item for today, which is multiple inheritance. So in C++, and you already saw it here, this is a multiple inheritance, right? We specify a type and we inherit from other different types, abstract types or complete types. And so in C++, you can inherit from more than one parent. That is really quite useful oftentimes. Some other languages do not support that. For instance, in Java, it's considered to be it's considered to be dangerous, and therefore in Java you can't have it. What's the reason why Java doesn't allow it? There's a problem which you can create using. Just give me a second. I have to close my Skype here. All right. Why do some languages not support that? Because there's something which is called the deadly diamond of death problem, or also in short called the diamond problem, that might occur when you use multiple inheritance and if you're not careful. And the situation is basically as follows. So you have a supertype, a base type A, and you have some subtypes B and C, which both inherit from A. And then you have a type D, which inherits from B and C again. And you may already see the problems are coming up. So maybe let's make it more explicit and model it in code. So we have A, which implements print. We and a virtual function, member function, which implements print here, prints A. We have a type B, which inherits from A, overwrites the print method to print B to the command line. And we have a type C, which inherits from A and overrites print to print C to the command line. And then we have D, which inherits from B and C. And you now maybe see the problem, which print function to use, because both of my parents and also the base type all pretty much implement a print. So which function should I use? Should I inherit? From B, from C? That's a tough question. So that's the problem here. If you now instantiate a variable D of type uppercase D and you call print, it doesn't know if it should use B's version of print or C's version of print, because both implement it in a different way even. So that's the deadly diamond of death problem. Luckily, C++ warns you when that happens, so the compiler will give you an error message, which is surprisingly quite understandable. So whenever you make such a mistake, the C++ compiler will let you know. And the problem can also be mitigated, so it's not a problem at all to solve it, really. Because what you can do is you could either use virtual inheritance, which I probably don't explain to you at all, or I explain to you next time. That is some different story, would go into too many details. Or even simpler, even easier, you could overwrite the print member function in D within the D type and then manually direct the call to the corresponding, to the right implementation. So let's have a look how the fix looks like. So you could fix it by implementing your own version of print within the D type, and within the implementation of D's print, you just forward it to B's print. And by doing that here, you make it explicit, so you now have your own version which explicitly forwards it to B's implementation. And then problem is solved, the compiler is happy, and compiler can now decide what should be called, because the compiler can't make that decision for you, and this is why you need to be explicit about it. And what you can do here is you can create a variable lowercase d of type uppercase d, and then you can call print on it. All works perfectly fine. And what will be printed? It will be printed B, because here D's version directs to B's version, and B's version just prints B. That's the idea. So now that would be it for today. There's a very interesting talk about object orientation and object-oriented programming and C++'s object model, which is called Intro to C++ Object Model by Richard Powell, which you can watch here. The recording is available online on YouTube. So it's a very interesting talk. And it explains all the details of polymorphic behavior and all that good stuff in much more detail. So unfortunately, I don't have the time for that. Otherwise, we would never be able to finish this course. But if you're interested in that and need a bit more exercise and background, you can you should probably go for that talk. And there's a second talk, which is called the Solid Principles of Object Orientation or Object-Oriented and Agile Design. By Uncle Bob Robert Martin. It was given in 2014. So it's an excellent talk. It's much more general on how to design software. So maybe one or the other of you is interested in that. You can also have a look at his talk. So very great talk if you plan to become a software engineer or software developer. So that would be also a very interesting talk for you, I guess. So, and this basically concludes our lecture today. So we discussed about static memory, the static keyword, and we introduced object-oriented programming. Thank you very much. So I would say we continue with object-oriented programming next week. And so far, have a nice weekend and see you later on in the exercise classes this afternoon. Bye-bye.